Hello, and welcome to the Birds on Power Lines podcast. We got a little off track with our plans for this episode when we accidentally came across a fabulous discussion between Neil Gaiman and rozkaveney about Neil, his books, other people's books, his inspirations, and all kinds of great stuff about Neil and his friendship with Roz. If you're interested, you can find it on YouTube yourself by looking for the British Library channel and the title, Why We Need Fantasy, Neil Gaiman in Conversation. We had an amazing time listening to this and a great conversation ourselves about what we heard and what it meant to us. And I believe I finally know how Crowley in Good Omens got his name, which is a reference to a previous episode of the Birds on Power Lines podcast. For the YouTube channel, I'll add the links below. If you're listening on Apple Podcasts, Podbean, or Spotify, you can find the YouTube version of the podcast on YouTube by searching for Birds on Power Lines podcast. And like I said, I'll be sure to include all the information for you to look up. For now, though, we hope you enjoy our discussion.
I'm really glad that we're going down this rabbit hole again with Neil Gaiman and Good Omens. I just really think it's cool that somehow the YouTube algorithm put that great talk between Neil Gaiman and rozkaveney and from the British Library into my YouTube. I don't think I would have ever have stumbled across that otherwise. So I'm going to try and put the link to that discussion between the two of them in the comments, or not in the comments, in the information below the video, so that anyone listening can look that up, because I think any Neil Gaiman fan should watch that. And I think it was called Why We Need Fantasy. So yeah, and we're just 10 minutes in, and all the stuff that we learned, right? There's like this new author that we want to look up with this book from 1926 called Ludinthemist, and the author's name is Hope Mirrlees. And then, you know, Neil wearing some sort of bird pin, it's just like of some kind in that interview, just like he there's something to a purpose with everything that he's doing. So, but to really continue our last discussion on Good Omens and the origin of Crowley's name, and then learning that Gaiman is a fan or an admirer of the work of John Crowley. So yeah, J. Crowley, we both kind of looked at each other when he said that. So I'm still not sure about the Anthony, but there is that J. Crowley. And so looking up the book that he mentioned in the discussion called Littlebig, also something to read, but I went down that rabbit hole, and I followed John Crowley to his website, which is called Crowley Crow. And then there's a link to the website for Littlebig, and on there's a quote by Neil Gaiman. And so there's definitely something going on here. And I really believe that, you know, compared to what we were looking at before, I really think this is the J. Crowley. You know, where Anthony comes from, I'm still not sure. But anyways, themes in Littlebig, which won lots of awards, is all kinds of things that come up in Good Omens. So in the interview, Gaiman didn't say anything about Terry Pratchett, but I'm sure that they are part of the same group. And looking at the themes of Little Big, so we have hermeticism, memory, families, and religion. So this was really quite something that I think has some bearing on some of the themes in Good Omens. So I wouldn't be surprised if Terry Pratchett was also a fan of this person, John Crowley. He's an American author. So yeah, it's, you know, 10 minutes into this special and we're like already down the Gaiman rabbit hole, and specifically the Good Omens themes again. So I really believe that, you know, following through on this whole idea of Crowley's name, that just like we also learned the beginning or the prelude or the book before Good Omens, or the book that Good Omens is based on, is William the Antichrist, right? Which we didn't know, but apparently there is a reference to that in a version of Good Omens that was put out. And in there, he does also say about the name Crowley being based on a town near where he grew up, right? But of course, in Good Omens, he makes a point, even in the book with Pratchett, I believe, not just in the TV series, that he changed the name, and he changed it to J. Crowley, or to Crowley. And so I do think that maybe Crowley was based on the village, like he says, of course, because it's Gaiman. But the change to Crowley and J. Crowley is, in my mind, more than likely because of this American author, John Crowley. So anyways, so that's my thought. And I do think it's interesting that we learn that Good Omens is based on William the Antichrist. So we should probably try to look at that too. And I think with this whole interview for the British Library, there's just so much there. I so much about all of his books, and I think we should just, take our time and listen to it, because I think we're having a good time listening to it. So it's kind of unexpected to do this for the podcast, but I think it's a fun thing to do. And especially because you're such a Neil Gaiman fan, and you're always trying to tell me about all of his books. And now I'm hearing about some of the origins of his books with this interview. So I think this is also the perfect opportunity for you to school me, and because you've really read a lot, even the comic books and the graphic novels. So I think that this is a great chance for us to just talk about Neil Gaiman. And I think it's pretty funny, learning about William the Antichrist and how the original character was Crowley, and that Terry Pratchett decided to split them into Crowley, or Crowley, and aziraphale. And that makes me kind of reflect on these interviews with davidtennant and michaelsheen, where they're laughing about how they're yin to the other's yang. And so literally, all this discussion that we see even on Sundaria's page about them being two sides of the same coin, I mean, that's obviously the even the way it started as an origin of the two characters. So I think that, listening to this library interview, we're learning so much. And then talking about Gaiman's other work that I'm familiar with now, not like you, because I haven't looked at the graphic novels or the comic books, but Sandman. And I always say to you, to me, Dream is Neil Gaiman. And then finding out in this interview that there's another graphic novel where Neil Gaiman is actually the main character, and the artist drew the main character to look like Neil Gaiman. I mean, I didn't know that, and I just think that whole thing is interesting.
Definitely think that, like, the Crowley name, like, how I think that's spot on. And I mean, even if it's not actually really connected, which I don't really know how it wouldn't be, but even if it's not really connected, it definitely is a huge coincidence. But I know, because, like, you were talking about Hermeticism and, like, John Crowley's book. And I know tarot is, like, also in Littlebig. Tarot was a really big thing in Littlebig, just reading from a summary. And I mean, as we know, it's also in Good Omens. Tarot is also a thing in Good Omens. And in the Wikipedia page for, like, Hermeticism specifically, I found a reference to the card the Magician. And I mean, I don't quite remember what Sundarius said about that one, but I'm pretty sure it popped up quite a bit in Good Omens, or like the symbolism that popped up quite a bit in Good Omens. So I have a feeling that there's definitely something more here than meets the eye. But I mean, also about Hermeticism, I mean, the symbol of Hermeticism is like a staff of Hermes with like the double snakes, and Crowley's like whole thing with like the snakes and stuff. It might maybe could just be a coincidence, but there seems to be there is something here. And I mean, also even really the whole idea of Hermeticism, like if I'm understanding it right, is like the whole idea of it summed up is basically like ineffability, and that's like the big thing in Good Omens. So I don't know. I don't know why there's so many similarities here between like the works of John Crowley, this little big specifically, Hermeticism, Tarot, all this stuff. I don't know why that's all there, but honestly, I do have a feeling that even if we might be jumping to conclusions, I think it's definitely a well-founded conclusion that there is something here. Don't know what. Maybe it was just Neil Gaiman wanting to pay homage to an author that he enjoys, which, of course, he can do that. He's Neil Gaiman. Anyone can do that. But it definitely is interesting to look at all of these connections. Honestly, like, I haven't really read as much of Neil Gaiman as I would like to. I mean, of course, I'd love to have read everything he's ever written. But I think a lot of, like, the messages in, like, and, like, as he was saying in that interview, like, he has a lot of things he apparently realized that he just writes a lot about, like, family and, like, the dynamics of the relationships between people. And, I mean, honestly, I don't know why I find that so interesting, but it just, I think it really just speaks to people on, like, a fundamental level. Like, the connections that they have with other people, like, seen through the eyes of fantasy, because, like, that's what fantasy does. It takes ordinary people and puts them in extraordinary situations, and that's honestly, like, why all of his things that he's written, I find, like, just very, very moving or very beautiful or just really very profound in some way or another. And I think it's especially interesting. I mean, I haven't read Violent Cases, but, I mean, definitely I would like to now that I know about it. But I just think it's so interesting that, like, both with that and with the Sandman, like, the main character or, like, the narrator, the person whose point of view you're seeing it from, either, like, pretty much is Neil Gaiman, or, like, is a character who's strongly heavily based or influenced on Neil Gaiman. And I feel like the reason that may have happened intentionally or not, because like, I oftentimes, like, the books of Neil Gaiman that I've read, they're all written from the perspective of one character and one character only. It's either written in, like, the first person eye, or it's written, like, just with one character, like, that everything is centered around, everything's revolving around this one character. Whereas in graphic novels and comics, oftentimes, like, you can switch between different characters more easily, or different storylines more easily, than if you're just writing a book, I would think. And I think it somehow, like, brings Neil Gaiman, like, back into the comic book, into the story, because, like, yes, he's the author of it, yes, he's written everything and all of it, but there is still some, like, creative license that the actual artists who are drawing the comic have, in, like, how they draw the characters and whatnot. But I think that, like, in basically putting himself into these situations, or, like, a very, like, a heavily stylized version of himself into these stories, he kind of is still keeping it, like, almost, like, true to what he was thinking, like, or, yeah, true to almost what he was thinking. But I think really what that whole fantasy talk is really kind of about, like, 10 minutes into it, 10, 15 minutes into it right now. What I'm getting from it is what I basically said, that all the things that Neil Gaiman has written, or that fantasy authors in general try to write, they're writing themselves or like, people they know, their family, or, like, things that have happened to them. They're taking their experiences and translating that into something that isn't quite recognizable as something that is real and that would happen, or but something that could happen in, like, a slightly different world, or maybe a very vastly different world. And really, I think that's part of the reason why, I mean, I personally like both Neil Gaiman and fantasy in general so much, is that it really, when it's written well, which of course Neil Gaiman very often does, in my opinion, when it's written well, it can really almost, like, reveal things about yourself, that, like, about the reader that you weren't aware of, or about the author, or really just about, like, how you see things in general. Like, I know definitely a lot of things that I've read by Neil Gaiman have definitely changed the way that I see certain things or the way I like think about things or associate like with different things that I see. It really leaves a very big lasting impact on you, and that's why I think that Neil Gaiman is such a skilled fantasy writer, because he knows that and he knows how to use that well, and also how people know that fantasy is done well if it has certain like a certain something in it that just speaks to you. Like, can't really explain it, but yeah.
Well, I've not read any of Gaiman's comics or graphic novels, which you have most definitely, Sandman. And having seen Sandman on television, Netflix, I think, right? I always, and I think it's funny, like I said, that I always think of Gaiman as the Sandman. And then to learn that there's another comic book where, you know, with violent cases with Gaiman is actually the character, that the person actually drew him as the narrator in the comic or in the graphics, really kind of motivates me to have a look at that too. And it's funny because if I Google this, and I say, you know, what comic strip looks like Gaiman, or, you know, a comic strip character looks like Neil Gaiman, I only get Sandman. I don't get anything about violent cases. So I'm intrigued. I think I want to have a look at that. And I guess we'll be trying to find that anywhere and any place that we can to have a look at that. The other thing that was fun to hear about in this interview or in this discussion with Neil Gaiman is the Graveyard book. And I've not read that. But I know you have, but I did find it funny that he says, oh, well, when I was writing the Graveyard book, that's like the Jungle book. And I mean, I get what he's saying. I get the idea because, you know, listening to Gaiman, I hear the premise of the jungle, of the Graveyard book. But personally, I find that link a little tenuous. I mean, I get what he's saying. But I'm really struck by how long it took for him to write the Graveyard book. And him thinking that he couldn't write it at when he had started in his 20s because he wasn't good enough yet. And then this whole idea of getting better by doing what you're doing. I just thought that was really an interesting philosophy. And then, you know, thinking about, and then he started talking about Sandman again, and, you know, getting better by doing what you're doing, and him reflecting that because Sandman was monthly, it sort of forced him to write, but in order to do that, he didn't want to have like a typical superhero. He had to have a character that would exist in any space and time, and that way he could write whatever was going on in his mind. And then, you know, hearing him talk about Wanda, and seeing that corollary being that Wanda was actually based on Roz, the person who's interviewing him, and I just was really taken aback by that, and how he talks about how he puts little bits of people he knows into his characters. And you know, and as someone who tries to write, I mean, I'm trying to get back to doing that, but I think that's really an interesting way of making your characters more real. And you know, thinking about the thing that I'm trying to write myself right now, and the criticism that I got after I sent it into the magazine, and thinking maybe I'm going to try and use that advice to try and add to what I've been writing and learn from the Gaiman. And I feel like I'm learning a lot just about how his brain works in terms of his writing, and how he gets these ideas, and really this is a lot of interesting tidbits. And it reminds me about reading books by other authors and learning about, you know, how they write and trying to learn from that and the significance that has on me. And I know this isn't Neil Gaiman, but thinking about learning from writers, the other book that or a book that really has meant a lot to me is Steering the Craft by Ursulakleguin, who is, as you know, a writer that I just love. I would love to hear what Gaiman thinks about Ursula K. Le Guin, because I just think it would be really interesting, because, you know, now that I'm coming into reading Gaiman now later in my life, I would say from my perspective that Ursula K. Le Guin, who I love, and Neil Gaiman are probably now like the top writers that I have in my head, even though I'm now reading this book by Hankgreen, or both of the books in series by Hankgreen, that I'm finding really amazing too. And I don't know why I'm surprised by that, but I just didn't realize how good of a writer Hankgreen was, but in terms of icons, Ursula K. Le Guin and Gaiman are probably ones that I'm going to really, really try to pay attention to and keep learning from. And I guess in case people are listening to this, if you're not familiar with Hankgreen's books that I might be reading, they are an absolutely remarkable thing and a beautiful, beautifully foolish endeavor, which I'm about halfway through right now. So, yeah. But really, also interesting books.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's very, like, telling, I guess, in a way that, like, he writes what he knows. Like, everything that he writes, like, even though everything is fantasy that he writes, like, he writes from things that, like, he's familiar with. I mean, like, even, I know we were watching, like, I think we were watching an interview with him about, like, when he wrote American Gods. It's a different interview. When he wrote American Gods, he actually, like, went to a few of the places, like, in the States, that, like, he was setting, like, events in order to, like, understand them, I guess. And it just is really, it's a very telling thing that he does. He does so much of this research, and the things that he doesn't research, he never writes about something that he's completely wholly unfamiliar with. And I feel like that's part of what makes him such a good writer, because you can tell that he knows what he's talking about, even though it's not possible for someone to have whatever done all these fantastical things. It's not possible, but in all of this fictitious telling, this fictitious entertaining telling of tales, he, like, there is a bit of a grain of truth in there, because these are things that have happened to him, things that have happened to other people he knows. He writes from experience, and I think that's what makes him such a good and compelling writer.
Yes, indeed. We did listen to a conversation with Neil Gaiman, or a piece on Neil Gaiman, where he did say that he spent time touring around the United States looking for locations for American Gods, and also for the Norse mythology books. I know that he also was inspired to start writing that when he was out there looking at a museum up in, I think it was Norway or somewhere up there, and that's where he got the idea of what if the gods traveled with the people over across the ocean, and what would happen to them there? And I think he even said someplace else that, you know, part of his job as a writer is to travel. And I thought that was really quite an interesting take. But it really seems to work. So it's true. He writes what he knows. And I think it was funny in the interview, because Roz was pointing out certain things about his books, such as, you know, them being about family and things like that. And, you know, he is writing what he knows, but sometimes there seems to be some sort of underlying theme that even he isn't aware of, but he is definitely writing what he knows. And even if he doesn't realize, he's completely pulling from stories in his own family, which I thought was really interesting. And then with that, Roz was saying that he's such a good person to go to bounce ideas off. And that's why she started writing sonnets. And then I thought it was really funny when Neil was saying, well, I was thinking that if the writing thing doesn't work out for me, that I could open an advice shop for writers, and they could just call me in and ask me questions, which I thought was absolutely hilarious. And then he was saying that's how he got to be good friends with Terrypratchett, and, you know, and that's how he knew that they could write Good Omens together, which was really interesting. And then he puts this aside
that Terry Pratchett was running some sort of a program where he could look at his books to see, you know, if there was influence from other writers. And he was really surprised when his book Pyramids, which I think is part of Discworld, I haven't read any of these, but he said apparently to Neil that, oh, it looks like, you know, there's some of you in that book. And Neil kind of sarcastically was saying, well, yeah, I wonder why that is. And so I thought that was really quite funny. And it really brings another dimension to the friendship that the two of them had or have. I mean, I know Terry isn't with us anymore, but I mean, that friendship and the closeness obviously is something that's still there, which I thought was really nice to see.
Another part of the discussion that I enjoyed was listening to him talking about very concise writing and you know, not using too many words and being, you know, to the point and how he's starting to use a fountain pen in order to try and avoid, you know, writing too much stuff. And then talking about how Ocean at the End of the Lane is one of his, he's very proud of it because it's, I think he said, you know, 56,000 words. And this is a novel that's bigger on the inside. So now I'm really intrigued because I want to sort of find out what he means by that. And you can really tell that, you know, Ocean at the End of the Lane and Coraline are two of his writings that he's particularly, I think, fond of, because I hear him bringing those two up quite often. And so I think I'm going to have to add both of those to my reading list. And this reading list is getting longer and longer as we're listening to more of this interview or this conversation between him and Roz. But I think it's starting to put a priority into the order of things of his that I want to read. And I figure you've read quite a few of these already, but I'm way behind you because I try to listen to them on audio. And even better, if they're on audio and Neil is reading them. So I just love listening to him read his own work. And I think it's interesting because a lot of authors are not good at reading their own stuff, but Neil, wow, okay, it's just like, you know, huddling down with a nice warm blanket and listening to him, you know, read his own stuff. So I'm gonna have to see if either of those are on audio and if he's reading them, that way I can at least listen to them in the car when I'm going to and from work. So we'll see, but yeah, so Ocean at the End of the Lane is, I think, is going to come up before Coraline for me, but I do know I need to read Coraline.
Honestly, like, the one thing that's kind of struck me, like, while watching this whole interview with, like, Neil Gaiman is that, like, because he's such, like, a hugely successful, like, author, and he's, like, I mean, he wasn't always like that, of course, but, like, especially in the past, like, 20-odd years, he's been such a hugely successful, like, world-renowned writer, but he still manages to be, like, very, like, down-to-earth, very, like, just human, like, as a person. Like, I really, there's a bit, like, near the end where he's answering questions in the interview, and one of them was about a poem that he wrote to support, like, a charity that helps refugees, and, like, we listened to that together, and it was just, like, it was very simple, and it was just, like, it's a poem, it was about, what keeps us warm, like, during the winter. And it, but the thing is, he didn't, like, because he talked about his writing process of this poem in the interview, and he didn't, like, completely, this is again going to the fact that he doesn't write what he doesn't know, but because he asked thousands and hundreds of thousands of people what do they think of when they think of warmth, and he put, like, all of that together into one simple poem. And but it was so like powerful, like, we listened to him read it in a video of his that they recorded for this charity, and we listened to him read it, and it just was so, like, it was so simple, like, there was nothing, like, hugely profound in it, like, in terms of the concepts, but I just was so struck by the fact that it was just such a, like, an ordinary thing, like things you would think of, blankets and, like just being with your loved ones and all these things, they're just so like normal. And but the thing is, he manages to make these like simple actions, simple concepts sound so profound. It just, it really has struck me that he's able to do that in such a skilled manner. But it really is quite amazing to both listen to him read something like as you're listening with the audiobooks, and also just read what he's written and really just think, you know, like anyone can do like what he's doing. I mean, there's only one Neil Gaiman, but anyone can write well, and they can, like, they have the potential to write in a like influential or like just profound manner if they write from their heart. And I feel like that's what this whole interview is really, this is something that I feel like I'm really getting from this interview, learning from this interview, that writing fantasy is about writing from like within, or just writing in general. And I think that's why, another reason why he is like such a very good author, because he writes about things that make him feel something. And the chances are, if it makes one person feel something deeply, then it probably will make a few other people feel something quite deeply as well. It might not be the exact same feeling, but it still is something that really like speaks to your emotions.
Yeah, you know, there were so many of these great points that came out in that Q&A session. It was almost, I mean, in many ways, it was just as rich, or even maybe richer in some ways than the actual conversation. And one of the highlights was that poem. And I actually looked it up. There's a YouTube version of it with Neil, and he's reading it. And there's a beautiful imagery that was also part of the collaboration. And I'm going to put a link to that, but it's at the UNHCR YouTube channel. And so you look for what you need to be warm. And it's just beautiful. And you know, talking about the things that Neil was saying about writing, and like you're saying, and the humanity. And I know in another part of the interview the conversation with Roz, and one of the things that he liked about writing Sandman is that he was able to write about things that bothered him, right? And he would incorporate that into the comics. And he wanted other people to be bothered by it as well. And I think that really speaks to, again, about his humanity and writing from the things that he knows and the things from the heart, just like you were saying. And that's probably why his characters live with you after you read it. And, you know, and the other thing, even in the Q&A, is that he's very approachable. And you could hear that some of the people have been practicing these questions, and, you know, for years probably, or you know, things that they wanted to ask him. So you could tell it was some of the things that they asked. And he's incredibly patient and very, very humble about it. And someone like him doesn't, a lot of people in that situation would not be like that. He's such a good listener, and it's really, really amazing when you think about, you know, that the heart that he has. And I think that the poem and how proud he is of it, because not just because he wrote it, but because of the way it was done, the collaboration with the other artists and with the people who gave him ideas. And the reason that poem is so beautiful is because we can all relate to the things he's talking about. It's not some sort of esoteric idea, but just, you know, a hot potato and a warm blanket. And I think, you know, he's justified in being proud of it.
And I mean, another thing, because like you mentioned him writing with the fountain pen to try and like reduce the like excess words he might put in a story, and like just really condense it down into like what needs to be said. Like, I think that's like a very like everything about like the way that he writes, the way he publishes, the way he like thinks about like literature is like a very like it's honestly like it's I feel like it's a bit refreshing because like I know he said like at the end of the interview he was talking about like digital versus print books and like how the influence that like the like that like technology has had on like the writing industry as a whole and I think it's like I mean I personally like I really did connect with the part when he really was like I'm not he really was saying he wasn't like a huge fan of like digital books because it just doesn't feel the same and like I think that's I honestly think that's pretty interesting because like I mean I also I understand like when I'm reading a book I mean I think that like digital books are perfectly great I mean sure they save like resources like trees and they also like they're more widely available because like not everyone can like has the space to have a paper book or like has the like the resources to get a physical copy of a book like so that's why I think that electronic books are a useful resource in like today's day and age because it also especially like I know personally I know a lot of people who say that they don't like reading they don't like reading physical books I mean I would argue that that time old argument that oh they just haven't found the right book yet but I do think that having like electronic books or like audiobooks of course also is useful but it I do still feel like if I were given the choice I would never pick an electronic book to read I would always choose a physical copy of a book because it just doesn't have that same like presence I mean I'm not the kind of person to like mark up my books usually unless it's for a class but like I just the whole experience of reading a physical book is quite different from reading like a book on like an e-reader and I just think it's like it's very interesting that he has like I mean I wouldn't call it old-fashioned or like traditionalist because like that connotation wouldn't really entirely be correct but for lack of a better like term to express this he has like just a very like not immodern but like just a very his way of thinking about like writing and reading is very just interesting to me because I also hold a lot of the same views on this kind of thing
and then just thinking about listening to a book one of the things that I like if an author is good at reading their own work is that then you know how it sounds to the author. Does that make sense? How it sounds in their own head or the characters that they're reading about. And I think that also adds another dimension. And I'm going to bring up the Brothers Green again. This time I'm going to bring up John Green. And I think I was listening to him read The Anthropocene Reviewed. And I just loved hearing him read that. He's just really good at it. So that's another sort of thought, you know, so if you can't have the physical book, listening to it in my mind is another way of doing it. I know you will look at an e-reader, but I'm not someone who's a big fan of that.
I did also bring in the point about how like the use of say like social medias in publishing and in writing and bringing together writers and bringing together creative forces. He brought up that point as something like he phrased it as like the age of like this kind of connection online is actually drawing to a close and I do think that he is almost right in a way about this and it is like quite unfortunate because like you said it had like in its early days like these kinds of technologies had the potential to bring so many people like together to find like a common creativity and to enable and like enhance collaboration between people and he said that like lately it has been like changing and people have been getting less cooperative and often social media has become kind of like the culprit of this like almost loss in creativity, because like, yes, people still do use social media to like share their art, share their writing, all these things, but it's becoming more of like an individualistic thing, like a more of like a me all the time thing, instead of how can we all like improve ourselves, improve like the world we live in through our creativity. And I think it's very interesting that he chose to like bring this point up, because like he's that one author guy, that one famous author guy who is always on like Tumblr and all that stuff. And he is like enmeshed in this landscape, but he also he still is trying to use it to like connect people with each other and form connections with the people that he is writing for. He's forming connections with his audience. And I just think it's very refreshing to hear someone who is like famous and successful speak about like social media in this way. Like he's not like outright condemning it, like, oh, it's a terrible thing, blah blah blah, but he's also not treating it as like something benign. He's just treating it as a tool that like it in the beginning was used in a way that was more productive for creativity and for connecting people, and something that's kind of lost its way a little bit. And though, I mean, although he did say that he feels that the age of social media being used as a form of connection is might be like coming to a close, he still does kind of persist in like trying to keep it as something that like helps connect people. And I really think that's a very beautiful thing, and it really I think it really just speaks to like the fact that he does, like, even though all of his books, at least the ones that I've read, they all are a little bit just off, a little bit like they have a little bit of like stuff you like dark and strangely like twisted moments, but that's because he's writing about like humanity, and because people do sometimes have these like little moments that are just terrible. But regardless of that, his books always do have some kind of a happy ending, or an ending that is like satisfactory in some way. And I feel like that really kind of speaks to like his hope for humanity, and really his belief in humanity, that like despite all of the things that like he writes about in his books, like all of these terrible, terrible things that sometimes happen to a lot of the characters in his books, in the end, like everything is all right. Like it might not be a perfect fairy tale ending, but like life doesn't have a perfect fairy tale ending. It has an ending that is livable. And it just is very interesting that I'm seeing this pattern over and over again. Like, because I have read quite a few of his books, even like the really weird, crazy, twisted books that he's written, like American Gods. The characters, like, they live on somehow, and they just keep going with their lives. And it just, honestly, it's, for lack of a better word, it's very inspiring.
Yeah, and that was really a deep sort of part of that Q&A. That whole thing about social media and the internet. And you weren't around when all this started. I most certainly was. And I remember that sense of community that the internet brought. I was on UBB boards for different authors like Anne McCaffrey and Terry Goodkind. And it was just such a way of bringing people together. And I made some really good friends in that way. And, you know, the internet isn't like that anymore, and social media is, it does seem like it has now become, you know, an individual enterprise, and people have their brand and all these different ideas. And again, like, you know, as I mentioned, I was reading hankgreen's book and books and that's a theme in those books as well. And he's someone who, as people who know the Brothers Green, they're really internet savvy, and particularly Hank. So I you know, and then hearing Gaiman talk about this and how he feels like things are changing and he doesn't know where it's going to go. But I tend to agree with him now that I don't really think about these things usually, but having that come up in this conversation was really interesting. And then having, and then the whole idea about writing and the rules about how to become an author are changing, and he doesn't really know where they're going to go. And which gave me pause, because I do have things I'm trying to write, and I mean, I'm not doing it yet, but I mean, I shouldn't say that there, I've got drafts written, but I put them aside for the last 10 years. And then going back on that thought, I mean, that's what he did with the graveyard book. I mean, he put it aside for 10 years. So it gave me inspiration on that regard and that part of the interview. But thinking about, you know, the now there's the rules are changing, and I don't know what that means. But I guess I'll have to think about it, because it would be nice to be able to write and share the stories that I'm writing. Not that I'd ever imagine that I'm going to be anywhere good like Gaiman and other people that I admire. But it does give one pause, and I know you're really good at writing, and you get a lot of encouragement with your writing. So if you choose to do that later, it'd be interesting to see how that all goes. And I look forward to seeing what you do with it. But so the changing landscape in terms of the internet and how things are losing the sense of community and shifting over to, you know, individuality is really an interesting discussion that came up, and it really gave me a lot to think about. So I think we've had a really fabulous discussion thinking about and going over aspects of this conversation between Roz and Neil. And I think what I want to do to finish up is just to bring out one of my favorite moments in that, and not just because I love the topic, but also because there was a huge audience reaction. And that was when Roz asked Neil about script writing. And Neil shows us his example, Good Omens. And he said when he wrote Good Omens 1, it was like a writing exercise, because he really didn't know how things were going to go, and he didn't know, you know, what the actors were like for real in these parts. But then when he wrote Good Omens 2, he said that he just had an amazing time with it, because he knew that David Tennant, for example, would do anything. And he could have Johnhamm now walk completely naked down the Soho set, and people wouldn't know what to do, because now they would not know if they should love him or hate him, because as Gabriel, you know, they didn't like him too much, but now as the lovable Jim, you know, and sort of do a number on people with that. And then with Michael Sheen as Aziraphale, and he was describing him as Aziraphale as being a sweet little cinnamon roll, after him being the go-to actor for creepy characters, and then have Aziraphale as break everyone's hearts and at the end of Good Omens 2, as Good Omens fans call it, the final 15. And then with Roz reflecting on that, and apparently Roz was in the hospital, and when she was watching Good Omens 2, and she said, well, yeah, I called you a magnificent bastard, and everybody started laughing. So I really thought that was such a really good sort of, you know, excerpt of the conversation between Roz and Neil. And I kind of wanted to reflect on that. And it's kind of nice to, you know, bring our little conversation about this conversation to a close by coming back to Good Omens. And I think now that we've listened to this conversation, we have a lot of homework to do. We've got all kinds of other books to read, not just by Neil Gaiman. And I'm interested in Roz's work too. I started looking her up as well. I was not aware of all of these things that she had done. And then other authors as well that the two of them were talking about, because they're both so knowledgeable in this, because that's what they do. So I think we have a lot to do and a lot to read, and I'm looking forward to doing all of that with you.
Thanks for listening to our take on the British Library's YouTube video titled Why We Need Fantasy, Neil Gaiman in Conversation. We hope you get the opportunity to listen to this video as well. We really recommend it, especially for anyone who's interested in Neil Gaiman. And as always, thank you for being part of the Birds on Power Lines podcast.